to a 174 average. Jay Bruce digging in to start tonight. High drive, left center field, racing back to the wall, Bourgeois. The Reds are National League Central Division champions.
The implosion of the Cincinnati Reds. There's a lot to say when it comes to the Cincinnati Reds. For the majority of the club's existence, there are mostly good things to say. However, over the last couple of decades, it's been pretty hard to piece together any form of positivity towards the organization.
Very superstitious. Leonard has had enough. He throws Pinella out of the game. Pinella says if he's out of the game, he's taking the first base with him.
It's been unfortunate to see the downward spiral the Reds have been on since the late 90s, especially for its fan base. The fan base of the team dates all the way back to 1869, just 4 years after the Civil War, making the Cincinnati Reds the oldest team in professional baseball. It took until the following year, 1870, for the team to finally lose its first game. They lost 8-7 in extra innings to the Brooklyn Atlantics. There is an abundance of history when it comes to this franchise, and it would take days to go over all of it. So let's run through some of the fascinating highlights of the club's past before we get into the Castellini era. For one, this baseball team has always been a fan favorite. Historically, the team has been known to please the fans before pleasing the league. In the 1870s, they were kicked out of the National League due to playing games on Sundays and selling beer to its fans inside the ballpark. Consuming beer was a huge no-no for the National League. So after changing their name from the Red Stockings to the Reds, they were invited back into the National League in 1890. And sure enough, they continued selling beer and playing on Sundays. It was a total power move by the Reds organization to the league, essentially planting their flag into the ground, claiming, "You can't tell us what to do or when to play." Something you will never see from any franchise in this day and age. Perhaps the biggest advocate for baseball, beer, and sauerkraut was a Cincinnati orphan named Gary Herman, who would later purchase the Cincinnati Reds in 1902. Herman is famously known as the father of the World Series, after brokering peace between the National and American Leagues. It was decided that the best team from each league would play a 9-game series at the end of each season to be claimed the world champion. In 1903, the first ever World Series was played between the Boston Pilgrims and the Pittsburgh Pirates, with about 100,000 fans in attendance throughout the series. Gary Herman was known to treat visiting club owners and sports writers with unlimited beer, German sausage, and sauerkraut during the games. In 1912, he ordered the construction of a new ballpark, later to be known as Crosley Field. It was said that everyone in the league appreciated traveling to Cincinnati for games because of Herman's notorious laughter and hospitality. Herman helped bring Cincinnati its first World Series victory in 1919 over the Chicago Black Sox, only for it to be considered tainted after finding out that Chicago had thrown the game in the name of sports gambling. Because the players throwing the game, by the way, which has never been 100% proven, although it's safe to say they did, a unanimous decision was made to name a single commissioner in charge of both leagues, which has been a lasting tradition still to this day. Since then, the Cincinnati Reds went on to win 4 more World Series championships, along with 8 more National League pennants. Their second World Series came in 1940 over the Detroit Tigers, led by pitching greats Bucky Walters and Paul Derringer. Their next claim to fame was in 1961 with batting greats Frank Robinson and Vada Pinson, although they fell short to the New York Yankees in just 5 games. Even though the Reds had lost that year, it was quite the memorable season, with Roger Maris beating Babe Ruth's American League single-season home run record of 60 with 61 home runs, which, by the way, lasted up until the 2022 season after Aaron Judge, also a member of the Yankees, crushed 62 homers. The 1961 World Series was also the year when Mickey Mantle had to exit the field in Game 4 after developing an abscess on his hip and bled through his uniform. Then came the 1970s, the glory days of the Reds. Anyone who has followed baseball in the slightest bit has at least heard the name the Big Red Machine. A Cincinnati native named Louis Nippert, the great-grandson of James Gamble, the founder of the Procter & Gamble Company, became the majority owner of the Reds in 1973. He was at the helm during the team's most successful era, winning both the 75 and 76 World Series. The Big Red Machine dominated the league throughout the entire decade of the 70s, being recognized by almost everyone as the greatest roster to have ever played. They managed to win 6 National League West Division titles, 4 pennants, and of course, the 2 World Series titles. Managed by Sparky Anderson, the roster was stacked with Hall of Famers and should be Hall of Famers, including Johnny Bench, Dave Concepcion, Joe Morgan, Pete Rose, Tony Perez, George Foster, Cesar Geronimo, and Ken Griffey. It was a roster like nobody had ever seen before, and with today's Moneyball scenarios, most likely will never be seen again. In December of 1976, the Reds traded away Tony Perez, and it's widely known to be the worst trade in Cincinnati Reds history. At the end of the 1978 season, the Reds had fired Sparky Anderson and lost Pete Rose to free agency, beginning the end of the dynasty. Shortly after that, Louis Nippert sold his shares of the ball club to its minority owners in 1981, and just like that, the Big Red Machine had fizzled out. It didn't take long for the team to bounce back. After acquiring Eric Davis, Chris Sabo, and Barry Larkin, the team ousted the Oakland A's in 4 games in the 1990 World Series. The 1990 Reds had arguably one of the best bullpens in National League history, led by manager Lou Piniella. By this time period, the Reds were being run by the incredibly controversial owner, Marge Schott. Marge Schott is quite certainly the most interesting woman to have ever owned a professional baseball team. Born in Cincinnati, a widow at age 39, Marge inherited her husband's wealth in 1962 after he died of a heart attack. That inheritance allowed her to purchase majority ownership of the Reds in 1984 for roughly $13 million. This is where it all gets weird.
There's something happening here, but what it is ain't exactly clear. There's a man with a gun over there, telling me I got to beware. I think it's time we stop, children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. There's battle lines being drawn. Nobody's right if everybody's wrong. Young people speak in their minds, are getting so much resistance from behind. Time we stop, hey, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
Yes, the Cincinnati Reds did win a World Series under the ownership of Marge Schott, whether you like it or not. Marge was known for a lot of things, like having the cheapest tickets in the league as well as $1 hot dogs. She was also known to throw the N-word around like it was nothing. Her outspoken support of Adolf Hitler also didn't help, which got her banned from managing the team from 96 to 98. However, people also remember her for donating incredibly large sums of money towards charities. Interesting enough, Marge Schott was all over the place. However, she ruffled many feathers inside both the Reds organization and the entire league, which was the start of the Reds implosion. Lou Lou Piniella had a quick stint in Cincinnati as the club manager, and after almost 30 years of managing throughout the league, Cincinnati was the only team he won a World Series with. He's locally famous for throwing first base into right field after getting ejected. After winning the World Series, Marchand offered him a two-year, $1.4 million extension, in which he declined, stating, "It just wasn't fun anymore." Lou Piniella literally stormed out of Marge's office, grabbed his belongings out of his Cincinnati apartment, and hit the road. Looking back at the scenario, Lou mentioned that he had no idea where he was going and had no job offers. He just started driving away from the city. So what exactly did Marge Schott do to make everyone in the ball club so worked up? Well, for starters, she was so obsessed with her dog, Shotzi. She brought him everywhere she went. She may have even taken it too far, though, as there are reports that the dog would relieve itself not only in the field during warm-ups, but also in the executive offices, in which she would never clean up after it herself. She literally rubbed players the wrong way by taking her dog's hair and rubbing it on the players who were on a cold streak to bring them good luck. That wasn't the only way she rubbed players the wrong way, though. During Game 4 of the World Series in Oakland, Eric Davis suffered a kidney injury while diving for a ball in left field. Marge Schott left Davis in the Oakland hospital and made him fly back on his own dime. When being interviewed about it a few days later, she said, "It has ruined it all for me," referencing that Eric Davis had ruined her joy of winning the World Series. Once Davis got back to Cincinnati, after footing the $15,000 hospital and plane bill, he stated Marge had no concern or any consideration about his welfare. Aside from that, Marge instructed the front office not to hire any black people, stating, "I'd rather have a trained monkey working for me than, well, the N-word." Oh no, we're not done yet. Marge Schott is also largely remembered for being one hell of a cheap witch. Not only did she charge the front office employees for coffee, she even charged them for tissues. She also made Lou Piniella pay for 3 baseball bats after he signed them and donated them to charity after a game. Marge even cut the cord on the outfield scoreboard that showed updated scores from around the league in order to save $300 a month on electricity costs. To top it all off, she outspokenly got angry at her players for winning the World Series in just 4 games instead of 7, stating that she could have made much more money if they hadn't won so quickly. Nobody wanted to work or play for her come the late 1990s. In 1999, Marge Schott had sold her controlling interest for $67 million to Carl Lindner, one of the world's richest people locally known for founding the popular chain called United Dairy Farmers. He ultimately paid about $180 million in total for all his shares. The people of Cincinnati thought that this was going to be a good turnaround for the franchise, especially after the construction of the Great American Ballpark in 2003. Although the Reds hadn't made it to the playoffs since Lindner's takeover, he touted that he would bring a winning ball club to Great American Ballpark. Well, in the ballpark's first season, Lindner fired both his manager and general manager, as well as gutted the roster for prospects and cash at the trade deadline. On opening day of the following season, just about every fan in the ballpark booed him as he stepped onto the field. The Reds finished under 500 throughout Lindner's ownership, which made it the longest losing streak in team history in over 50 years. Both Lindner and the fan base had had enough of it, and in 2006, Lindner sold his controlling shares to Bob Castellini for $270 million. When the Castellinis bought the Reds, Bob had claimed, "We're buying the Reds to win. Anything else is unacceptable." To this day, many Cincinnatians would agree that the Castellinis would need to learn how to keep their mouths shut. This is when the implosion of the Reds really begins to pick up steam. For generations, the Cincinnati Reds were looked up to in baseball. How could such a fun and historically great team turn into the laughingstock of the league? Well, poor ownership will do it. So let's take a look at the ownership of the team from the 1800s until now. Gary Herman builds Crosley Field and is adored by both fans and league executives as he brings home a World Series. Then you have Francis Dale, who built Riverfront Stadium and makes perhaps the biggest trade in MLB history, bringing in Joe Morgan, Cesar Geronimo, Jack Billingham, Ed Armbrister, and Dennis Menke, who then sells the team to previously mentioned Louis Nippert, who brought in two consecutive World Series titles. Then you have the Marge Schott fiasco, which turns over to Carl Lindner and now Bob Castellini. Since Bob Castellini took over the Reds in 2006, the team has a pathetic record of 1,255 to 1,397. Needless to say, it's been a slow and painful process. However, the team has officially reached its lowest point in its 154 years of existence. It's now 2023, and the team is heading into spring training with its best player, Joey Votto, at 39 years old, leading all active players with 2,093 hits versus the second place hit leader, Jonathan India, with just 239. Take out an aging Votto coming off the worst season in his career, the team doesn't have a single active player with over 250 big league hits. For anyone who has followed baseball throughout the years, that is quite the incredible stat. You could say it's almost impressive to even form a major league roster with such little accomplishments. This is not a AAA team we're talking about. This is the major leagues. With the team in such disarray, fans are leaving in droves chanting, "Sell the team, Bob," everywhere they go. In the 2022 season, the local fan base even gathered enough money to put up a billboard not far from the ballpark that said, "Sell the team, Bob." On opening day of the previous season, Bob Castellini's son Phil went viral overnight when he had the chutzpah to say, "Well, where are you gonna go?" during an interview with local radio host Mo Egger when asked about how he felt with the fan base's frustrations.
"Well, where are you gonna go? Let's start there. I mean, sell the team to who? I mean, well, that's the other thing. I mean, you wanna have this debate? You know, if you want to look at what would you do with this team to have it be more profitable, make more money, compete more in the current economic system that this game exists, mm-hmm. it would be to pick it up and move it somewhere else." Yeah. "And so be careful what you ask for."
"I won't go so as far to say it's insulting, but I would say that it does kind of put a damper on what is arguably one of the largest holidays in Cincinnati, opening day, historically. I mean, this is our day."
That quote single-handedly drove Reds fans to their boiling point. Throughout the franchise's history, it's easy to say that the fan base has never been so disappointed with the team, and they're letting it be known. Last season, Great American Ballpark brought in the worst attendance since 1984, bringing in just 1.3 million people throughout the season. Drive 350 miles to St. Louis, another small market team, who brought in 3.3 million people into Busch Stadium. That's 2 million more fans than Great American Ballpark. And by the way, the Cardinals have the third best record in baseball since 2010. So the answer to Phil Castellini's question of where you gonna go is apparently anywhere but the ballpark. The local radio hosts are doing everything they can to bring in any form of excitement towards the team. All you hear is the word prospects. While some fans are excited for the prospects, stating, "Give it another couple of years and this team's going to be great," most fans have had enough of the charade. Many disgruntled fans claim, "We've been saying that this team is 2 years away for two decades." In the 2020 season, the Reds managed to make it to the playoffs as the seventh seed, only to be swept in two games by the Braves. Although they went scoreless in the 22 innings played, fans were finally excited for the next season. They had Trevor Bauer, Cy Young winner, on the mound, carried by heavy bats such as Nick Castellanos, Joey Votto, Jesse Winker, Tucker Barnhart, and Eugenio Suarez. Well, The next season came, and even though they got rid of Trevor Bauer, they still managed to have decent pitchers such as Luis Castillo, Sonny Gray, Amir Garrett, Wade Miley, and Tyler Malley. They finished the season 4 games above 500 and barely missed the playoffs, leaving the fans unhappy, but still hopeful. Everyone in Cincinnati knew that the team was just a couple of moves away from being a serious contender. And then it happened. What happened next is what single-handedly ignited a fire amongst every Reds fan alive. Reds fans have been becoming increasingly more upset over the years, but they've never been as upset as they are right now. By the trade deadline of the 2022 season, the Reds managed to get rid of Sonny Gray, Luis Castillo, Nick Castellanos, Jesse Winker, Tucker Barnhart, Brandon Drury, Tyler Naquin, Amir Garrett, and Eugenio Suarez. The front office completely gutted the entire roster, driving all hopes of winning down the drain. They finished the 2022 season with 100 losses, which was the second time ever in franchise history. Not to be outdone, during the offseason, Phil Castellini ruffled more feathers by presenting a PowerPoint presentation on, wait for it, why the Reds are so bad. One slide was titled, Teams Out of Contention by Opening Day. It had a chart of teams that apparently had zero chance of making it to the playoffs by the first game of the season. Can you guess one of the teams that was on that list? Yes, his very own Cincinnati Reds. He claimed that he's running the team as a non-profit and that the baseball industry is in crisis mode. So before the first pitch of spring training is yet to be thrown, the Reds fan base is essentially being told from the team's owner that they have no chance of making it to the postseason. So what's next for the Cincinnati Reds as we head into the 2023 season? The roster has potential rather than proven capability. The roster has an average age of 27.2, which includes veteran Joey Votto at age 39. The pitching staff is young, however it looks pretty strong with Hunter Green, Nick Lodolo, and Graham Ashcraft. Jonathan India is poised to have a breakout season, and fans are ecstatic about the exciting prospect Ellie De La Cruz, a 6'5" shortstop who can obliterate the ball. Although the team does look like it's on a good path towards success, most fans are on fumes, and you can't blame them. They're saying, why get excited for a team that will be gutted as soon as it starts winning? Which to their defense is quite true, as most MLB fans think the Cincinnati Reds are a farm system for the rest of the league, saying, hey, come to Cincinnati. If you play well enough, you'll get the chance to be traded away to a real team. It's quite unfortunate to witness such a great fan base go into such a disgruntled state. Think about it. These are the fans of the oldest team in baseball. So what are the fans going to get in exchange for going to the ballpark this year? The team is charging $14 for craft beer, $15 for ultimate nachos, and ownership has already told everyone that they have no chance of making it to the playoffs. It leaves the lingering question of, can the Castellinis win back the fans, or do they ultimately need to sell the team? Sure, they have an exciting group of developing players, and on top of that, the best mascot in the league, Mr. Red. But is Mr. Red solely enough to keep the fans happy? Well, as great as he is, the fans care about one thing and one thing only. Winning.
1-0 on Brandon. In the air, left center field. Did he? He did! Reds win!
Well, I tell you what, we've talked about the C word all night. That is clutch. Oh, my goodness. What a way to start the second half.
We are currently witnessing the lowest point in Reds franchise history, with attendance, player performance, and overall team morale at their all-time lows, this is going to be a very interesting season. Will fans still show up and be excited after the All-Star break? Or will they give the Castellinis an even worse attendance record than last year? Will the team lose another 100 games and make it the first back-to-back 100 loss seasons in franchise history? Or will the young players turn this thing around? Perhaps there's one big reason why the Castellinis are not selling the team just yet. When you look at the historic trends of the team's ownership, the Castellinis are right on pace to sell the team rather soon, if not immediately. They bought the team shy of $300 million back in 06. The team is now worth an estimated $1.2 billion today. Bob could make a 400% return on his investment if he sold the team right now. There can't be a month that goes by where the Castellinis aren't at least thinking about what that could mean to their family and individual portfolios. With just about everyone in the baseball community asking them to sell the team, and with a sales price of over $1 billion, why aren't they selling? Could it be that they truly believe in 1 or 2 years' time the Reds will be World Series contenders? Perhaps they see how great this team will be in 2025 and don't want to give the next ownership all of the credit. Or perhaps they honestly just don't care and are having too much fun being in the driver's seat on the path towards completely ruining the most nostalgic baseball franchise in all of history. What do you think?